Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Henry Strozier, and I'll be your host. Today, we begin a course entitled Odyssey of the West, Part 2, a classic education through the great books, from Athens to Rome and the Gospels. This course is taught by a variety of professors, each of whom speaks to a subject of his expertise. Professor Timothy Shutt of Kenyon College serves as the host, while Professors Joel F. Richeimer, also of Kenyon, Kim Hartswick from the City University of New York, and Lawrence Schiffman of NYU all contribute lectures on the early history of Western civilization, the subject of this survey. The integrated program in humane studies at Kenyon College has inspired this course, an interdisciplinary overview of Western culture from its origins in the Middle East to the present day. In the lectures that follow, we will draw upon the resources of a wide variety of fields, from history to philosophy to literature to art history, to engage the deepest and most profound aspects of the West. A variety of professors, each an expert in their field, will contribute their view of the subjects that have formed the basis of the world we know today. Part 2 of this course, which you're listening to now, picks up where Part 1 left off, bringing us ever closer to our own time and the world we've inherited from this vast range of influences. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Odyssey of the West, Part 2, a classic education through the great books, from Athens to Rome and the Gospels. Lecture 1, The Peloponnesian War. And now, Professor Timothy Shutt.
Thucydides, an Athenian, wrote the history of the war between the Peloponnesians and the Athenians beginning at the moment that it broke out, and believing that it would be a great war and more worthy of relation than any that had preceded it. This belief was not without its grounds. The preparations of both the combatants were in every department in the last state of perfection, and he could see the rest of the Hellenic race taking sides in the quarrel, those who delayed doing so having it in contemplation. Indeed, this was the greatest movement yet known in history, not only of the Hellenes, but of a large part of the barbarian world. So begins what, even now, 2,400 years more or less after its completion, is generally considered the greatest work of history ever composed. Thucydides' History of the Peloponnesian War, which is to say the war which took place from 431 to 405-404 between Athens and allies and the Peloponnesian League and allies, most notably Sparta, but also Corinth and an array of other Peloponnesian poleis, or city-states, and a war which came to involve the Persian Empire, which at that time extended from modern Bulgaria all the way to what is now Pakistan, and which had in prospect, had things gone as the Athenians wished, or claimed to have wished, a war which finally would have involved Carthage and the Western Mediterranean basin. In that sense, for its time, at least so far as the Western world goes, it was a world war and really was, as Thucydides claims, the biggest war that had ever transpired up to his time. It's a big war in other ways, too, and an important historical event in other ways, too. In 490 at Marathon, in 480 and then 479 at Thermopylae, at Salamis, and ultimately at Plataea, the Greeks united Spartans, Athenians, Corinthians, and others, some others, had succeeded in holding at bay the Persian Empire, which was the largest empire, and in many ways, to be fair, the best governed empire the world had seen up to that time. They fought, or so they imagined. Indeed, so they devoutly believed, in service of their freedom. And they won massively outnumbered though they were, in large part, so they believed, because free men fighting for their homelands and for their freedom fight vastly better than, as they rather unfairly put it, slaves driven into battle by the whip, fighting for the whim of their emperor, their great king. After that stunning and surprising victory over the Persian Empire, the Greeks, and particularly the Athenians, underwent what it would be fair to call a cultural explosion. This is when the Parthenon is built, and the Peloponnesian War brought that moment of intense cultural self-confidence. If we can beat the Persian Empire, for crying out loud, we can beat anybody, and we can do anything. From 479 to 431, the beginning of the Peloponnesian War, that 48 years, that generation and a half or two generations, marked a peak of which, sadly, tragically, the Peloponnesian War marks a kind of conclusion. And this, too, Thucydides is well aware of. And indeed, as Thucydides writes his history, a thematic undercurrent is that the very excesses of the virtues of Athens in particular are what brought about the arrival of nemesis and destruction. The pretexts for the war, the putative casus belli, were exceedingly complicated, and Thucydides outlines in almost painful detail the ins and outs of the negotiations that preceded the conflict. But his judgment, and it's a judgment that virtually all of his legatees have come to accept, is that the root cause of the conflict between Athens and Sparta was Spartan unease, and indeed wider Hellenic unease, the Greeks, of course, called their region Hellas, at the rise of power of Athens in particular, the unprecedented rise of power of Athens. Up until the Persian Wars and through the Persian Wars, the dominant state in Greece, highest in prestige, most admired, and so forth, had been Sparta. Sometime about midway through the 50-year break between the Persian Wars and the Peloponnesian Wars, Athens surpassed Sparta, and as time went on, surpassed Sparta more and more and more. Sparta was the head of the Peloponnesian League, hence the name of the war from an Athenian perspective. From a Spartan perspective, it would have been the Athenian War, of course. And the Peloponnesian League included almost always Corinth, the great commercial city on the isthmus between the mainland of Greece and the Peloponnese, and various other cities in the Peloponnese, and indeed some other cities beyond. It was, in theory, a league. Sparta was the most dominant partner by a considerable margin, but nevertheless a voluntary association. I suppose a fair analogy, both with the dominance of a single partner and in its general character, might be something like NATO. Athens also had its group of affiliated states. And that had started historically at the end of the Persian Wars as something called the Delian League. The idea was that the Greeks would continue the fight against Persia, trying to liberate in particular Greek cities on the west coast of what is now Turkey, in Ionia, in Asia Minor, which were still under Persian control, and the various Greek islands in between. The Spartans, after playing with this idea for a little bit, opted out. They were more land-based and were more interested in maintaining their hegemony in the Peloponnese and surrounding regions, for a variety of reasons, not least because their financial power was based on the enserfdom of a large neighboring population of a subclass whom they termed Helots. Athens, with Athens' mighty navy, victors at Salamis, along with the Corinthians and others, was interested in pursuing further the war against Persia. And most of the coalition members who had fought Persia originally opted in to continue with Athens. Athens was willing to accept, and in fact was happy to accept, in lieu of naval contributions, ships and trained men, financial contributions so that Athens could subsidize its own navy. All the better, then Athens had control, direct control of the military power. It makes sense. You can see why Athens would want this. And the treasury for this league was put on the island of Delos, sacred to Apollo, and stayed there for a good long while. In mid-century, however, Athens decided to move the treasury and began to use the monies gathered not just for the Athenian fleet, but for huge public works projects in Athens, among them the Parthenon. Athens' allies, it can be well imagined, were less than entirely convinced of the immediate military utility of the Parthenon as a deterrent against Persia. It led to some ill feeling. Athens responded, "Hey, you seen any Persians recently? So where's the problem? Okay, we're using the money in an effective way. Your needs are being met. Enough already." But that transformation led, gradually, to the reconfiguration of what had been the Delian League into a de facto Athenian empire. And an Athenian empire which, by virtue of its unmatched sea power, could strike virtually at will, was willing to strike virtually at will, and on occasion did strike at will. They did successfully continue the war against Persia, especially under the name of a man by the name of Cimon or Simon, son of Miltiades, the victor at Marathon. But pretty much everybody who was not held more or less by force by now in the Athenian Empire favored Sparta and was made profoundly uneasy by the rise of Athenian power and was very much ready, this has resonances with other times and places, to see Athens taken down a peg or two. Thus, when the war started, sympathy across the Hellenic world was by and large and strongly in favor of Sparta. It's not just, however, because of the clarity of the narrative and the importance of the events narrated that Thucydides is so influential. He's influential as well on methodological grounds. Despite the excellences of Herodotus, who I would be the last to hold in any kind of disesteem. I love Herodotus. Even so, Thucydides is much closer to the standards of contemporary historiography than Herodotus, father of history, is himself. And professional historians and others have always valued that in him. He does, and this paradoxically perhaps, because this is not something that modern historians are inclined to do, but Thucydides does, and he uses it as a method of exposition of what he takes to be the underlying themes. He says, "My habit has been to make the speakers say what was, in my opinion, demanded of them by the various occasions on which they were speaking. Of course, adhering as closely as possible, to the general sense of what really was said." I mean, he faces some substantial problems in getting verbatim accounts. This is an age without video cams, without tapes, and so forth. People trained their memories in those days so that they were vastly more proficient than we need to be now, and hence than we are now. But even still, he freely confesses he can't remember what was said verbatim, even when he was there. But what he does is this opens up for him an opportunity of, in effect, putting into the mouths of the principals involved in a given situation what he takes to be the underlying important themes and issues at stake. So you get a kind of built-in commentary. As a result of all this, he says, "The absence of romance in my history will, I fear, detract somewhat from its interest. But if it be judged useful by those inquirers who desire an exact knowledge of the past as an aid to the understanding of the future, which in the course of human things must resemble it if it does not reflect it, I shall be content. In sum, I've written my work not as an essay, which is to win the applause of the moment, but as a possession for all time." Much as historians love and admire Thucydides, however, They are not the only contemporary professional group who finds in Thucydides a model and a mentor. He is equally admired, at least equally admired, by political scientists. He begins his story with a series of negotiations taking place between Corcyra or Corcyra, the modern island of Corfu, which was a Corinthian colony, now at least the equal of Corinth in power and slightly its superior in naval power, and important because it is on the route between Italy and the West and Greece, so in a good position to choke things off at that point, should they be so inclined, and the mother city of Corinth, which was, of course, a member of the Peloponnesian League. And what actually begins the Peloponnesian War is a Corcyran attempt to gain Athenian help in their designs, hence going against the perceived interests of the Peloponnesian mother city of Corinth. And we are treated by Thucydides to a full debate on this topic between the Corinthians, the Spartans, the Corcyrans, and also, so we are told, by some Athenians who happened to be in Sparta as this issue was discussed. Here is what the Athenians say about their actions in effect, founding the Athenian Empire. It was not a very remarkable action, or contrary to the common practice of mankind, if we accepted an empire that was offered to us and refused to give it up, under the pressure of three of the strongest motives imaginable: fear, honor, and interest, self-interest. And it was not we who set the example, for it has always been the law. And here is the body punch. It has always been the law that the weaker should be subject to the stronger. Hence the Athenian argument. Well, it doesn't go down terribly well with the Spartans and Corinthians, unsurprisingly. They go on to say, "Besides, we believed ourselves to be worthy of our position, and so you thought us too, till now, because we led the naval fight, if not the land fight, against the Persians. When calculations of interest, your self-interest, have made you take up the cry of justice, come on, a consideration which no one ever yet brought forward to hinder his ambition when he had a chance of gaining anything by might." Don't talk to me about justice. We all know that that's a tissue of lies. It's all about machtpolitik, power politics. We could and we did, and so would you. So shut up and don't try to cloud the waters with all this talk about right and wrong. Excuse me. Right there. Although he is very reticent and understated about this, right there we see the root of Athens' destruction. This is a tale, among other things, of hubris and nemesis. The Athenians go on to suggest, "Praise is due to all who, if not so superior to human nature as to refuse dominion, yet respect justice more than their position compels them to do." And that, the Athenians imply, is us. We're not totally just, but we don't entirely toss it out the window. And hey, that's all anybody can ask. It gets worse. So why did it get worse? Well, in part because of the Athenians' notion of who they were and what they were about. And this is expressed for us with definitive clarity in the speech that Thucydides attributes to Pericles, the funeral oration very early on in the war. Pericles says, "We, Athenians, are rather a pattern to others than imitators ourselves. Our administration favors the many instead of the few. This is why it is called a democracy. Demos, the people, kratos, power, all power to the people, a democracy. If we look to the laws, they afford equal justice to all in their private differences. If to social standing, advancement in public life falls to reputation for capacity. Class considerations not being allowed to interfere with merit. In truth, not being allowed to interfere too much with merit. But nevertheless, there's considerable truth in what he's claiming. Unlike Sparta, we throw open our city to the world. Anybody can come to Athens, anybody can live here, not as citizens, but nevertheless, and lots choose to do so for obvious reasons. While in education, where our rivals from their very cradles by a painful discipline seek after manliness, we at Athens live exactly as we please and are yet just as ready to encounter every legitimate danger. We accordingly have the double advantage of not suffering hardships before we need to and of facing them in the hour of need as fearlessly as those who are never free from them. In short, I say that as a city, we are the school of Hellas. We and the way we do things are an education to the Hellenic world, to Greece, and by implication, to the world. In short, despite their excellences, they are from an external rather than an internal perspective, in part because of their very sanguine self-image, a real pain. I said before that this attitude led to worse, the worst. And Thucydides, again, with suppressed anger and disgust, but it is suppressed, portrays this as the moment, I suppose, when the Athenians decisively lost anything resembling the moral upper hand. And despite the superiority in many respects, most respects, most people would argue, despite the superiority of the Athenian system and Athenian culture to its rival in Sparta, nevertheless, the Athenians deserved to lose this war to the Spartans, who during the war on the whole behaved certainly with more self-restraint, by and large, and on the whole better. Here is the scenario. The island of Melos had not been part of the Athenian Empire. It had connections of a sort, meanwhile, with Sparta, but had remained neutral. The Athenians arrive and say, you have to ally, quote unquote, with us. In other words, you have to join our empire. The Melians don't want to do it. And the Athenians undertake to force them. They say, you know, Melians, as well as we do, that right, as the world goes, is only in question between equals in power. And let us remind you, we are Athens and you are Melos. While the strong do what they can and the weak suffer what they must. That's probably the most famous line in Thucydides. While the strong do what they can and the weak suffer what they must. The Melians reply, how can you avoid making enemies of all existing neutrals if you proceed as you're planning to? They will conclude, looking at our case, that one day or another you're going to attack them too. Of gods we believe, say the Athenians, and of men we know, that by a necessary law of their nature, they rule wherever they can. And we can rule you, Melos, and we're going to. Well, the Melians refuse to accept this ultimatum and fight against Athens. And the result is that, after resistance, the Melians surrendered to the Athenians, who put to death all the grown men whom they took and sold the women and children for slaves, and subsequently sent out 500 colonists and settled the place themselves. So the Athenians at this point are not shy about using their power to the full for their own benefit. Macht politik unbridled. This raises an issue, though. Is Thucydides endorsing this view of how you should go about using power? I don't think so. Again, he never says so. He writes and explores how such things happen and is certainly as clear-sighted as he could be in maintaining that more often than not they do happen. But the results for Athens suggest, and his placement of significant incidents within his narrative suggests, that this kind of behavior leads to overreach, and overreach leads to disaster. To the Athenians in this round, offstage, after, in times after Thucydides has concluded his story, for the Spartans as well, for the Persians. That, he seems to imply, is another law of nature. Push it too hard and you will fall. The war began again in 431, and very shortly after that, Thucydides gives us Pericles' magnificent funeral oration. But there's a bit of hubris even there, and immediately following the funeral oration, we get an account of the plague which struck Athens. Right after that, part of the problem was the Spartans' tactic was to invade Attica and lay waste as much as they could to the farmland surrounding Athens, however, had walls all the way to the Piraeus, and they just took all of their citizens into the city itself. But the overcrowding certainly contributed to, if it didn't cause, the plague. And in the plague, he says, people lost all sense of honor, lived only for the moment. It was incredibly corrosive of civic virtue, religious observation, and so forth. So that's sort of the first instance where we see this movement of hubris nemesis. You flip the page and you begin the account of the Sicilian expedition, which it's astonishing that Athens survived this. They were engaged at this point in the classical equivalent of a world war against Sparta, the greatest land military power, certainly soldier for soldier, in the world at the time, beyond elite, splendid warriors on land, and they decide to invade Sicily, Syracuse in particular. Syracuse is a city as big as Athens. Sicily is, by Mediterranean standards, a gigantic island. And they send off an expeditionary force to try to conquer Sicily. It is, to put it mildly, a gigantic dissipation of their powers. And they bite off way more than they can chew. Their hope is, once they've conquered Sicily, the Western Mediterranean will lay in their grasp, and they can go to Italy, take over Italy, maybe fiddle about with Spain a little bit, certainly take on Carthage, which is a major power. Athenian ambition is at this point totally unbridled. And the result in the Sicilian expedition is disaster. They lose essentially everybody they send, and they send gigantic for Athens armies. Tens of thousands, many tens of thousands of troops, ships, and they are all lost. The person who was most responsible for bringing about the expedition was a pupil and purportedly a lover or would-be lover of Socrates and the ward and relative of Pericles, a man by the name of Alcibiades, who was fabulously able, undefeated for life in battle on four different sides over the course of his life, seducer of the queen of Sparta, an astonishing figure. And he was the one, Thucydides tells us, who pumped the Athenians up to try for Sicily and Syracuse, and he was the one also who whetted their appetite for the conquest of the whole Western Mediterranean basin. Right as the Athenians were about to embark, there were good luck charms in effect at street corners in front of houses throughout Athens, which were called herms. On the top of the herms, there was a bust in effect of Hermes with an erect phallus carved into the face of the plinth below. These were defaced all over the city, which was read as an act of desecration and by machinations, the course of which escaped me and escaped pretty much everybody else. It was also taken as a threat to the democracy, and Alcibiades, wrongly probably, was blamed. He offered to stand trial right then and there. He was one of the commanders of the Sicilian expedition, but his enemies were afraid that the sailors and soldiers involved in the expedition would vote against his condemnation, and so they let him go. After he was gone, they condemned him in absentia and sent the state galley out to bring him home so that he could stand trial and presumably be executed. He wasn't buying. He fled to Sparta. And when he was in Sparta, made the argument, I made the Athenian plans. You want to know how to beat the Athenian plans? Nobody can tell you better than I can. The Spartans were a little skeptical, but Alcibiades was chameleon-like. He was working away at out-Spartaning the Spartans, and they essentially took his advice, part of which was to send help to Syracuse. The Spartans were frugal with their resources. They did not send a full-scale expedition. They sent a very tiny one, but they sent a Spartan general, a man named Gylippus. And that was enough to turn the tide. The Athenian expedition ended in disaster. Well, Athens, after the Sicilian expedition, found themselves in a very parlous state. The war was all but lost. They kept on fighting. Alcibiades, however, meanwhile, having worn out his welcome in Sparta by, among other things, as I mentioned before, seducing one of the Spartan queens, went over to the Persian side, argued to the Persians that the best course was to do everything in their power to assure a draw between Athens and Sparta so that they would destroy each other to the benefit of Persia, and then began to angle to get back in control in Athens, at which he succeeded. And amazingly, though this is when Thucydides stops, his narrative stops before the conclusion of the war, turned it around and put Athens back on top again. But being Alcibiades, he got in trouble again. The Athenians cashiered him. He went off to Thrace to gather Thracian tribesmen to, in effect, sell to the highest bidder. And other folks took over for Athens and succeeded. This is astonishing to me. In winning a huge naval battle, the Battle of Arginusae, the war was all but theirs, but a storm blew up after the Battle of Arginusae. They had a hard time rescuing the folks who were casualties floating around in the wreckage in the water. And of the generals who came home, they chose to execute them. Amazing. After winning this decisive battle, they chose to execute. This sort of hastiness and vengefulness is something also that Thucydides chronicles repeatedly in the Peloponnesian War. Well, having gotten rid of the generals by execution, having gotten rid of Alcibiades, in 405, the Athenians came up, they'd met him before, against a tremendously able and tremendously unscrupulous Spartan commander named Alcibiades as naval operations were going on in the Hellespont region. Again, vital to Athens for the grain shipment. And the Athenians would go out every day. Ancient warships were tremendously unseaworthy, and they did not, by choice, stay at night on the water if they could possibly avoid it. But they just parked on a beach, and then everybody walked miles away to get lunch. The Spartans, meanwhile, were in a real-life harbor across the way. Alcibiades happened to be nearby. He came down to the general and said, this is a really bad idea. If you stay here, the Spartans are going to get you. They said to him, in effect, you're not in charge anymore. Get out of here. We don't want to listen to you. Leave. He did. Immediately thereafter, Lysander took his fleet across while the Athenians were at lunch and pretty much entirely destroyed it. That was the end of the war. The Spartans controlled the Hellespont. They started to starve Athens out. Lysander sent every Athenian who was out of town that he could find home to increase the pressure on their food supplies, and Athens surrendered. That is after the conclusion of Thucydides' narrative, but he lived to see it. And though Athens made a fair comeback, things were never the same again.
This ends Lecture 1. Odyssey of the West, Part 2, Lecture 2, The Rise and Fall of Athens. And now, Professor Shutt.
Though he evidently lived to see the end of the Peloponnesian War, Thucydides never finished his history. And the task of finishing it was taken upon himself by Xenophon, an Athenian who later became a Spartan sympathizer of sorts, and indeed late in his life fought for a time on behalf of Sparta against the Athenians, though he reconciled to some degree by his life's end. He's most famous for his Anabasis, or Journey Up Country, which describes how he served with the brother of the Persian great king, Cyrus, is the brother, in an attempt to take over the throne as one of 13,000 Greek mercenaries, an attempt that came to grief at the Battle of Cunaxa in 401, and Xenophon then led the mercenary group back to Greek territory. The work that we're concerned with here, though, is not the Anabasis, though that's his most famous, but instead his Hellenica, or as it's translated in the Penguin version, A History of My Times. Xenophon, I find agreeable and admirable in many respects, but by near universal consensus, he is not the sophisticated historian that Thucydides is. Nonetheless, he gives us the major account which we have, the other coming from the so-called Oxyrhynchus historian from a papyrus discovered at Oxyrhynchus in Egypt. He gives us a major account of the very end of the war, which winds up astonishingly and grimly with the Athenian fleet in the Hellespont, the Spartan fleet under the command of Lysander on the other side of the Hellespont, the Athenians trying to lure the Spartans into battle unsuccessfully and very unwisely after they go out to do this each morning, returning their ships to the beach and wandering off to the nearest town to lunch. Astonishingly enough, Alcibiades, the notorious and charismatic Athenian commander, had a private castle nearby and went down to the beach, we are told, and let the Athenian generals and admirals know that they were asking for trouble against Lysander, beaching their ships the way they were. He was told to mind his own business. He was no longer in command. And sure enough, immediately thereafter, Lysander did precisely what Alcibiades had predicted, caught the Athenians on the beach where only a small detachment under an Athenian commander named Conan escaped, and the Athenian fleet was destroyed. The next year, Athens was besieged and surrendered, putting an end to the Peloponnesian War and an end to, likewise, the Great Age of Athens, and in some sense, the Great Age of Classical Greece. Things were never the same thereafter. The Thebans and the Corinthians wanted to destroy Athens, to inflict on Athens the same sort of draconian punishment that Athens itself had inflicted, among others, on the island of Melos, killing all adult men and enslaving all women and children. But the Spartans, to their credit, refused, saying they could not and would not do that to a city who had given so much to Greece in the Persian Wars in particular. They contented themselves with installing the so-called 30 tyrants, an oligarchic regime, and having the long walls to the Piraeus, backbone of the Athenian defense, taken down, so Xenophon informs us, to the sound of flutes, provided, one presumes, by Sparta and not Athens. The Spartans, in fact, remained dominant in the region for a while, but their hegemony was ended at the Battle of Leuctra in 371, 33 years later, by Epaminondas and Pelopidas of the city of Thebes. In 362, at the Battle of Mantinea, the Thebans and their allies won again, and refounded the city of Messina, freed most of, if not all, of the Spartan helots, and reduced Sparta to a second-rate power, a status from which Sparta never recovered. And then, in 338, Philip of Macedon conquered a Greek coalition at the Battle of Chaeronea, and the age of the polis was, in effect, at an end, and we move on very shortly to Alexander and Hellenistic times, about which more in a subsequent lecture. Meanwhile, however, intellectual developments continued apace in Athens, and these intellectual developments were of various kinds. The Parthenon, of course, was already constructed, though the Propylaea was left incomplete as a result of the Peloponnesian War. The great age of tragedy was past, but comedy continued. Aristophanes, the greatest of the Greek comedians, wrote throughout the Persian Wars. He was born sometime in the 450s, sometime between 450 to 460, died about 386, and his comedies, we call them old comedy, Attic old comedy, are very astonishing things. If you can think of a Saturday Night Live type fantastic contemporary quasi-political skit extended to full play length in a realm where there are no libel laws, and you can say absolutely anything and attack absolutely anybody, with lots of costumes, lots of obscenity, lots of verbal extravagance, you'll get the flavor of what Aristophanic comedy is like. The most famous are the birds, the frogs, the wasps, the clouds. Lysistrata, which involves a sex strike on the part of Athenian and Spartan women in hopes of putting an end to the Peloponnesian War, peace, and so forth. They are vivid, colorful, amusing, topical, and so often hard to interpret, since, sad but true, we are not totally au courant, even the most scholarly of us, about political affairs in Athens and the wider Hellenic world at the time. Nevertheless, they're unlike anything which came before, so far as we know. I suppose satyr plays are some sort of predecessor, and unlike what came later. The next round, so to speak, is new comedy, and the headliner there is a figure by the name of Menander, who was born sometime around 344-43 and died about 292-91. We see lots of those Virgulian Greek dates. That's because the Greek New Year, in any case, the Athenian New Year, fell in midsummer. So Greek years are kind of like our academic years. They tend to be recorded as 334-33, something like that. In any case, those are the dates of Menander. He's quite different, though. The political topicality is by no means so prominent. The fantastic invention, choruses of frogs or birds and so forth, is also gone. And though the plays of Menander, those fragments and very few remains that survive, are generally speaking less highly regarded by critics than those of Aristophanes, the genre which Menander helps to found has proved much more durable, and it is, in essence, the formula situation comedy. New comedies, they're picked up later in Roman times, the genre, and in some cases the plots as well, by people like Plautus and Terence. These comedies generally involve marriage, thwarted love affairs, jealous old fathers, clever slaves, and so forth, in a kind of domestic parade of folly and cleverness, which is very familiar and which you can tune in to TV and find pretty much any night of the week in modern guise. Comedy, thereafter, begins to trail off, but paradoxically and perhaps surprisingly, the great age of Athens was not the great age of philosophy. The great age of philosophy, which we'll hear a good deal more about in the guise of Aristotle and Plato, comes by and large after the Peloponnesian War. Our goal in the remainder of this lecture, though, is to take a look at the predecessors, the pre-Socratics, the people who initiated philosophical and quasi-philosophical investigations in Greece, and also the sophists, the professional teachers of rhetoric and very highly paid professional teachers of rhetoric, who were notoriously, according to Plato at least, the rivals of Socrates, and whom, according to Aristophanes, Socrates was himself one. The question arises, why Aristophanic comedy at the time when the Athenian democracy was certainly coming under ferocious pressure as a result of the Peloponnesian War? The quasi-libelious free speech and invective which characterizes Aristophanic comedy is an extension, in a certain sense, of the invective and ferocious debate which characterized the Athenian assembly during the time of the Peloponnesian Wars. A democracy under pressure, or at least this democracy under pressure, tends to get more rather than less acrimonious. And Aristophanes, if you vector out that acrimony into an artistic rather than a rhetorical context, you're going to find yourself squarely in the middle of Aristophanic critique of what is going on in the political world. So if you have pressure plus freedom, it's not so hard to see how Aristophanes comes to be, and it's also not so hard to see how, after the 30 tyrants have been imposed, after Athens is subdued, after the democracy has been restored, but in a chastened guise, and Athens herself has been chastened, the focus turns to more domestic concerns, and we get things like the new comedy of Menander. And also, though I'm less convinced of this, of philosophical investigation, particularly of human conduct. You can make an argument that this represents a shift to some degree away from rhetorical and sort of agonistic contest-oriented verbal concerns, as in the law courts and as in the assemblies, towards a more detached analysis of virtue. I'm more inclined, though, with regard to philosophy, to attribute the shift to the sheer mental power of the great triumvirate of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, who would presumably have reshaped the discourse of whatever time they'd been born into, and also the intrinsic development of philosophy as a field. The roots of philosophy, however, lie not in Athens, but in Ionia, on the other side of the Aegean Sea, in what's now the west coast of Turkey, particularly in the Greek islands and in the city of Miletus and other nearby cities. These were thriving at the time when Greek philosophy, Ionian philosophy, was born and, in fact, went into a decline after they rebelled against Persia in the prequel to the Persian Wars and were reconquered when their revolt faded, and they never recovered. It's surprising to learn that Miletus, for instance, in the century before the revolt against Persia and the Persian conquest, was far more influential, far more sophisticated, far more populous, far more involved in trade than Athens herself. And it was in that commercial entrepot and that rich cultural mix that philosophy began. This is one of the most important and indeed arguably, and I would argue, in fact, the single most important contribution.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.